Welcome to Uncommon Knowledge. I'm Peter Robinson. Be sure to visit our new website, if you would, at hoover.org/UK. Hoover.org/UK. Hoover stands for the Hoover Institution, the think tank at Stanford University. Joining me today, James Delingpole, a columnist for the London Daily Telegraph and the Spectator magazine. James Delingpole is the 2010 winner of the Frederick Bastiat Prize for Online Journalism, the author of a series of comic novels set during World War II and featuring his hero, Dick Coward, Coward on the Beach, Coward at the Bridge, Coward in the Woods, to name a few of the titles. Mr. Delingpole is also the author of books on politics and economics, including 365 Ways to Drive a Liberal Crazy and Welcome to Obama Land. Mr. Delingpole's most recent work, Watermelons, The Green Movement's True Colors. Mr. Delingpole is here today to argue more or less that the world is about to end. James Delingpole, welcome to Uncommon Knowledge. Watermelons, green on the outside, pink on the inside?
Red on the inside, yes.
Red on the inside.
Absolutely, yeah.
Segment one, The Trouble in Europe. James Delingpole writing last month on Ricochet.com, quote, "However bad you think things are in the U.S. right now, being in Europe at the moment is like standing on the prow of the Titanic and watching the iceberg approaching. No warning you yell to the bridge is going to make the blindest difference, because even the captain knows the ship is doomed." Doomed? Doomed. You're being provocative.
I hope I'm being provocative, but I fear I'm not. If you look at the history of the European project, right from the beginning it was designed to thwart the democratic process. The founders of the European...
When you say the European project, you're referring specifically to what started out as the economic, the European market and the European Union.
Yeah,
EU,
yeah.
What Americans would think of as the EU. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, it's interesting you mention, you know, the market. I think one of the great misconceptions about the European Union is that it was a good idea, a sort of trading zone, which suddenly went bad. It was always part of the plan for the European project, as devised by Jean Monnet. It was designed to be a political union, but brought about through the back door. What Jean Monnet understood very clearly from the start was that no sovereign people could be persuaded to join a political union over which they had no democratic control. So what he did was create this system called engrenage. Engrenage means ratcheting, where people are gradually sucked into the European Union, little by little, slowly, slowly, softly, softly, catchy monkey. And this is what has happened. Now we have what is sometimes known as the beneficial crisis. Beneficial, that is, to the Eurocrats who want political union. They've forced the countries, the member states of the euro, into a position where, if they reject political union, they face the terrible economic collapse that is on the horizon now. So they have no choice but to allow their fiscal policies to be dictated by the European superstate, not by their democratically elected governments.
All right, take a look at Angela Merkel, Chancellor of Germany.
Für uns muss nur klar sein, davon dürfen wir uns nicht entmutigen lassen. Wir haben es geschafft, 2008 die Finanzkrise zu überwinden, und zwar genau nach dem Motto, Deutschland wird gestärkt aus dieser Krise herauskommen. Und jetzt müssen wir es schaffen, dass Europa stärker aus seiner heutigen Krise herauskommt, als es hineingegangen ist.
We must succeed in getting Europe out of this crisis stronger than when it entered it. Now, 6 decades of the European project from the end of the Second World War to the present represents 6 decades without conflict in Europe and 6 decades during which, despite ups and downs in economic growth, Europe achieved a standard of living that it had nowhere else in all of European history approached. So isn't that a perfectly reasonable assertion? We must strengthen Europe, not let it fall apart.
It's interesting, isn't it? A lot of the early advocates of the European Union, for example, people like Ted Heath, believed...
Former Tory Prime Minister.
Alleged Tory, yes. These people believed, honestly, that many of them had served in the Second World War. Right. They obviously didn't want it to happen again. And they thought by creating this sort of European superstate, although they didn't call it that then, they would avert another war. Actually, I think what's going to happen is that it will create war. Because what you're going to find is that in countries like Greece, for example, the Greeks at the moment are having to submit to having German technocrats fly into Athens to tell them how to run their country. Now, the Greeks are a proud people, as indeed are the Italians, as indeed are the French, as indeed are all the member states of the European Union.
And the critical point is the Greeks still feel Greek. They don't feel European. The nation still exists in their minds.
More than that, nobody in Europe feels European.
Oh, but don't the Germans... I thought the German impulse is that the weight of history is such that they really, at some level, want to lose their identity as Germans. They don't want to feel the weight of that history upon them. So, in the case of the Germans, you can almost understand the psychology of wishing to dissolve their
de-German.
National identity. Yes, exactly.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly. That is probably true.
Detoxify the brand.
Teutonify the brand.
Right, right.
Yes, absolutely. I think in the case of the Germans...
One can see it then.
The Germans feel deeply embarrassed about being German for obvious reasons.
Right.
And I think this, is part of the problem because they don't understand in the same way that other European countries do what it means to have your national identity of which you are proud. But equally, I think that it's unfair to blame the Germans too much for what's going on here. I don't think that although the Germans want a healthy Europe, a healthy trade zone, I don't honestly think the Germans actually want to be, A, bailing out countries like Greece, and B, imposing this kind of German version of affairs on Europe.
It's just
what has happened
right.
as the inevitable result.
What's the way forward, James? The European project has happened. It's six decades on.
Yes.
The euro may have been a mistake. We'll just talk about Britain in a moment. It may have been the wisest, if most inadvertent, decision that Britain ever made to stay out of the euro. All that may be true.
Yes.
But the euro is the currency. So what do you want to see happen? Do you want to see the euro? You want to see a formal dissolution of the European Union?
Yes.
What do you want to see?
Yes.
You do?
It cannot but be otherwise. There has to be... You cannot have a currency where, on the one hand, you've got the strong northern economies with their work ethic, with people working, not being paid their pensions until they're 65 or 70, with basket cases like Greece, with the economic and social values of southern Europeans, where they retire at 51. We have a two-speed economy yoked together painfully by this single currency. There has to be at least two currencies, maybe one with a breakaway sort of soft euro with the French as the main economy and the Italians and the pigs.
But even the two, I just want to probe you on one more point.
Yeah.
Even if you go into two currencies,
yeah.
you're still subsuming national identities into two currencies instead of one. You are not arguing for it. This is it. The European Union doesn't work. Go back to the drachma in Greece. Go back to the lira in Italy. Oh. And let nations as proud nation states that have evolved through the centuries, let them negotiate bilateral trade agreements. Let them work out currency arrangements. Let's go back to the system of nation states.
Oh, that would
back
be,
to the Treaty of Westphalia.
That would certainly be my dream scenario. I'm just talking about what is practicable at the moment. What the European Union is going to wear. I think it is inevitable that the euro will collapse. It's a question of whether it's going to be ugly or really, really, really disastrous.
All right. Segment two, the trouble in Britain. In the elections last spring, the British threw out the Labour Party, giving the Conservatives, also known as the Tories, enough support to enable them to form a coalition government and making David Cameron the first Tory Prime Minister in more than a dozen years. Two quotations. The Economist. Cameron's government is turning out to be searingly ambitious in taming the state. It wants to cut public spending more deeply than anyone expected, and it intends to make sure that whatever state is left is more local, flexible, and responsive to the people who pay for it, close quote. James Delingpole, writing in The Telegraph, quotation two, quote, It requires real talent and serious effort to become the worst Tory prime minister in history. To be honest, I never thought Cameron had it in him. Close quote. James.
What a
terrible
terrible controversialist that second writer was. I think the first quote is proof, never believe a word you read in The Economist. It is an appalling excuse for a magazine, which purports to tell us the truth, the sort of the wise point of view on political affairs. Cameron has been a disaster for Britain. He's been a disaster for conservatism. He belongs to a very dishonourable tradition, which you can trace back through Edward Heath to Harold Macmillan. And that tradition is one of managed decline. This form of conservatism...
Well, you could trace it, for that matter, you could trace it all the way back to the Middle Ages. It's the paternalistic impulse. It's the grandee on the estate looking after the peasants. You can trace it all the way... Isn't that right?
Yeah, I'm not as old as you. I can't remember the early period.
Coming from a long line of peasants, we know that tradition
You're absolutely right, Peter. Yeah. David Cameron is no Margaret Thatcher. Even before he became Prime Minister, he styled himself as the heir to Blair. So he is no real conservative. Margaret Thatcher had a vision for Britain, and that vision was we were going to roll back the state, we were going to enjoy a kind of industrial recovery, or an economic recovery at any rate. We were going to cease this decline into sort of the Albania of the Western world. And
she made it happen.
She made it more or less happen. She fought her battle with the miners. Right. She deregulated. She privatized. Cameron has no such vision other than this wishy-washy thing called the big society, which is a bit like Tony Blair's third way.
Hold on. But David Cameron was faced with a very specific political problem. For a dozen years, Labour dominated the British landscape. Yep. Mrs. Thatcher, for all her achievements, poll after poll after poll showed that she was terribly unpopular. William Hague, three Tory leaders. I can't remember the names, but in greater or lesser fidelity to the tradition of Margaret Thatcher, led the Tory party into elections and got crushed.
Yes.
And David Cameron says, as a political matter, we need to detoxify the brand.
Yes.
I think that was the phrase they actually used in Tory circles. And he did it. And you may say that he's no Margaret Thatcher, but you would also have to grant that he's better than Gordon Brown would have been, right? What I'm probing you on, James, is I'm trying to work out the extent to which you take into account practical political politics.
Yeah, politics is the art of the possible.
I'm not
sure that... that was Bismarck. I'm not sure that I'm a great Bismarck fan.
He had the Prussian army to help him make
things possible. You talk about detoxifying the brand, but at what cost? The cost that the Conservatives have paid, the price they've paid for this, is that every scintilla of Conservative ideology has been thrown out of the window. So that what you have is this kind of jellyfish party, which doesn't really have any particular political viewpoint other than that it would quite like people to vote for it. Now, that represents a problem. Had Cameron taken the bold, bold position and made the case for conservatism, he would have created what is sometimes known as clear blue water between the Conservative Party and the opposition. People would have had something to vote for.
Right.
There was no real choice in this election. In fact, I think one of the great frustrations in Britain at the moment is that all the three main political parties are offering exactly the same pabulum.
All right. Life in Britain today.
On Tuesday night, it was Manchester's turn. Youths, some looking as young as 10, rampaged through the city centre, vandalising stores and coming away with what they could grab.
One of the biggest lessons of these riots is that we've got to talk honestly about behaviour and then act, because bad behaviour has literally arrived on people's doorsteps, and we cannot shy away from the truth anymore. So this must be a wake-up call for our country. Our security fight back must be matched by a social fight back. We must fight back against the attitudes and assumptions that have brought parts of our society to this shocking state.
This shocking state. Those riots took place this past summer.
Yeah.
Again, I mentioned this with regard to the continent, but it's true as well of Britain. Since the Second World War, 6 decades of peace, economic ups and downs, but fundamentally greater prosperity today than Britain has ever before known. What caused those riots?
There is now, I think this is the consequence of welfarism, European-style welfarism, which I think you're learning a lesson rather well from us. You've adopted America. And I think it's been a social disaster. What you have is the creation of this client underclass, which has never known what it is like to work, which has no skin in the game. You know, if you went back to Britain at the time of the Second World War, however poor people were, they felt a British identity. They felt they were part of the culture. They felt that they were, you know, heading in the same direction.
The British empire and her commonwealth should last 1,000 years, people will still say this was their finest hour. And when Churchill said there, everybody on the island felt he was talking about them.
Yeah.
Well, right? That's your point?
Apart from the Marxist dock workers who, you know, and a few others.
But who did their best to trip it all up.
Who did their best to trip it all up. But generally, that is true. Now you have this urban underclass who have formed an unfortunate alliance with the kind of the Occupy crowd, you know, these disaffected students. Those riots in the summer had nothing to do with social deprivation. These were bored kids out to grab what they could because they felt that why not? The police were letting it happen. The police force under New Labour, under Tony Blair, had been emasculated. They ceased to be a police force and became instead a kind of diversity outreach programme.
And the Prime Minister, David Cameron, says, let this be a wake-up call.
Yeah, yeah. He can
use it. Is he awake?
He's not awake. No, he's not. This big society plan of his is not going to achieve anything. It is just wishy-washy, you know, mood music, okay. Nothing more than that.
Last question about Britain. So much, well, actually, we want to touch on more or less every aspect of Western civilization.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's do that. let's sort out the world's problems, Peter.
All right. You sound to me like a British version of a Tea Partier.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
We have a Tea Party.
Yeah.
It is a politically effective movement that sprang up in the last 2.5 years, roughly,
yeah,
and has already, look at the Republican gains in the House of Representatives, transformed the American political landscape.
Yeah.
That's what's happening here.
Yeah.
Query, Britain, mother of democracy.
Yeah.
In the House of Commons last month, 80 members of the Tory party defied Prime Minister Cameron, voting to put the country's membership in the EU to the people in a referendum. Which sounds interesting. 80 people said we should have a vote on this. 80 members of the Conservative Party in the House. Polls indicate that the number of British people, the proportion of British people who want such a referendum is 2/3. So 80 members out of 305 Tory members of the House of Commons. Why is the Tory party not responding to the British people? It looks as though democracy just plain isn't working. The transmission belt from the people to Parliament is broken.
I think you underestimate the significance of that number, 81. Had it been
81, sir.
Had it been 20 or 30 right. rebel MPs, David Cameron, who is quite a Stalinist beneath that cuddly exterior, could have crushed
party
them.
Discipline.
He could have crushed them.
Right.
You cannot crush 81 MPs. That is a serious rift in the Tory party. Many more Tory MPs privately agree with the 81. But, you know, I mean, politicians are careerists. Some right. of them have to look after their, you know, their future, they're trying to get places in the cabinet and so on. But I think that is the beginning of the resistance. Another significant factor is that UKIP, the UK Independent Independence Party,
right.
has now got in the polls 7% of the vote, which puts it 1 percentage point away from the third party, the Liberal Democrats, who are currently in coalition with the Conservatives. Now, this could be...
UKIP, the United Kingdom Independence Party, their platform is very simple. Get out of Europe.
It's more than that. In fact, there is virtually no difference between what the UKIP thinks and what the Tea Party thinks. It is about, okay. It is the party of small government. It is the party of liberty.
All right. Segment 3. Is it getting hot in here? former Vice President of the United States of America and Nobel Prize winner, and I hope you're impressed, Albert Gore.
This really isn't about politics or ideology at all. This is a moral issue, an ethical issue, and in the highest sense, it really is a spiritual issue.
In the highest sense, a spiritual issue, to which James Delingpole's soulless, heartless, unspiritual response is...
Well, do you know what? I find myself in agreement with Al Gore there. It is a spiritual issue in that the Green Movement has become the world's most powerful new religion. So, yeah, you are dealing with religious dogma now. You're not dealing with science. You're dealing with religious ideology.
Meaning the facts simply don't come into play.
Absolutely. Right. It is a religion founded on junk science.
From your book, Watermelons, The Green Movement's True Colors, I take a deep breath because this is so bracing, outrageous.
I try.
Imagine that everything you knew about the environment was wrong, that global warming was something to be desired, not feared, that organic food, sustainability, biofuels, and the World Wildlife Federation, WWF, were far more harmful to the world and its inhabitants than genetically modified food, industrial oil, and Exxon Mobil. Imagine if it didn't matter one jot how big your carbon footprint was. Close case. Close quotation. May one suppose, Mr. Delingpole, that you are engaging in the most outrageous overstatement for the sake of argumentative provocation?
No. Every word you've just read out is entirely true. And actually, I think the Republican voters among your audience will know that already.
Global warming is something to be desired?
Well, yeah. If you look at the history of the human species, you look, for example, at the bountiful period of warmth in Roman times, in the medieval warming period. These were times when civilization flourished and grew. Why? Because if you look at the distribution of humans on the planet, you realize that we tend to do better in warmer places rather than cold places. We can survive at really, very northerly latitudes, but nevertheless, we tend to congregate where it is warm, where we don't have to spend so much time trying to keep warm, where we can grow
but
crops.
Okay, grant you that for the sake of argument. That was the planet's natural cycles.
Yeah.
What we have now is a growing population. The 7 billionth child was born, according to the United Nations, sometime last month. And economic growth, the early phases of economic growth, as demonstrated in China and in India, which between them account for something like 3 billion people, involves the burning of huge amounts of carbon fuels. And so, fine, maybe a little global warming every few centuries does us some good, but we're talking about a secular, sharply rising trend, and we'll fry ourselves within a couple of centuries.
Well, we're not, though, are we? If you listen to Al Gore, we're facing a rise in temperatures of up to 4 degrees C by the end of this century. Well, actually, if you look at the real-world data, as opposed to the crazed computer models of the activists pushing this scam, what you realize is that they're entirely within normal bounds. This idea that there is a correlation...
The problem that most of the increase in temperature of the 20th century took place in the first half of the century.
Yeah, I mean... Sure, CO2 emissions, anthropogenic CO2 emissions have risen, but there does not seem to be a disastrous increase in temperatures as well. In fact, global warming stopped in 1998. We are entering a 30-year cooling cycle.
Who says that?
Well, real scientists using real-world data as opposed to scientists who are using projections.
Okay, James, maybe they're right. Maybe that you're right. But listen to this. Your favorite publication, once again, The Economist magazine, quote, "Some scientists think that the planet is already on an irreversible journey to dangerous warming," Al Gore. "A few climate change skeptics think the problem will right itself," James Delingpole. "Either may be correct, but the broad scientific consensus is that serious climate change is a danger, They're not saying certainty, a danger. And this newspaper, The Economist magazine, believes that as an insurance policy against a catastrophe that may never happen, the world needs to adjust its behavior to try to avert that threat, close quote.
Yeah.
An insurance policy. They may be on to a little something. You may be on to a little something. We can't be sure, but the risks of running this experiment with the planet are too high.
Yeah. It's known as the precautionary principle. And by the same token,
pretty reasonable.
It is quite possible that there is an alien race out there which is bent on coming to the Earth and destroying us, like in Battlefield LA. It could happen. Does this mean that on the precautionary principle, we should prepare for this potential disaster by building giant death lasers on every continent? What about asteroids? Shouldn't we worry about them? If an asteroid hits us, it could be disastrous. We could go the way of the dinosaurs. That, again, is a thing we should be preparing for. What you have to ask yourself is how likely is it?
And what does it cost?
Cost-benefit analysis. Right. What is completely missing from this whole mass hysteria outbreak is a sense of proportion, of cost-benefit analysis. Look at what is happening to the American economy right now. You may have noticed it's not looking in very good shape. Now, was it really wise of President Obama to allocate $38.6 billion of taxpayers' money, or maybe of borrowed money from China, investing in clean tech startups like Solyndra, which has cost the taxpayer $527 million, like Robert Kennedy Jr.'s company, which has taken the taxpayer for $1.6 billion? Where is the benefit from this? Where is the...
All right.
Yeah.
Segment 4, the scam. Once again, from your most recent book, Watermelons, quote, "It was another dreary November morning in 2009, and I was sitting at my desk wondering what to write next." I know the feeling, by the way. "Into my lap dropped the story, Climategate, which would not only change my life forever, but quite possibly help save Western civilization from the greatest threat it has ever known," close quote. Okay, we'll get to Climategate.
Yeah.
But come on, James, the greatest threat Western civilization has ever known? What about Adolf Hitler? What about the thousands of nuclear weapons the Soviet Union had aimed at us for all those years?
There's an order of difference here. The thing about both the Soviet Union and Adolf Hitler's Germany was that the enemy was plain in view. We knew these guys were bad. They had black uniforms. They had swastikas. They had tanks. They were obviously the bad guys. They wanted to destroy us. What makes the modern environmental movement so dangerous is that it masks its intentions behind this cloak of cuddly, touchy-feely, polar bear hugging.
Nobel Prize winning
righteousness. Ordinary people identify with this stuff. What could be nicer than trying to save those little cuddly polar bears from melting, you know, due to our wanton greed and selfishness? It gels with a sense that I think grew in the affluent 90s, where people started asking themselves questions like, shouldn't there be limits to growth? You know, isn't there more to life than consumption? So you had this alliance of ordinary people, of kids who'd been brainwashed at school, of the big corporations which wanted to get in on the act by greenwashing their image, of powerful NGOs like Greenpeace and the World Wildlife Fund, of politicians being want to seem to take action to address issues of public concern. So what you had is this unstoppable bandwagon all pushing this agenda based on the flimsiest of junk science. That's the problem.
And claiming the moral high ground in a way that they're not. Okay. Climategate. Computer server at the Climatic Research Unit at the University of East Anglia is hacked. Thousands of emails and computer files go up on the web. And according to Wikipedia, quote, "James Delingpole popularized the term Climategate. Climate skeptics allege that the emails revealed scientists manipulating climate data and suppressing their critics," close quote. Was this the moment when the curtain fell, or no?
I think the groundwork had been done by McIntyre and McKittrick, the two Canadians who exposed the hockey stick curve, the Michael Mann's famous graph, which showed that as showed that we were going to hell in a handcart.
That there would be an inflection point when suddenly temperatures would rise and reverse quickly and
exactly.
Right? Okay.
But what Climategate provided, Climategate was the smoking gun. It provided what the evidence of what we had hitherto suspected but had been unable to confirm. Mm-hmm. It was also significant because it came just before the Copenhagen summit. And actually, I think it helped torpedo that summit below the waterline.
That turned out to be a bust.
Yes.
The governments of the world did not agree to place caps on carbon emissions. And
yeah.
Stuff. All right. New York Times editorial, quote, perhaps now, excuse me, this is an editorial from last July after Climategate had run for some months. Perhaps now we can put the manufactured controversy, you're doing the manufacturing,
yes,
known as Climategate behind us and turn to the task of actually doing something about global warming. A panel in Britain has concluded that scientists whose email had been hacked late last year had not distorted scientific evidence. Another climate change controversy may also be receding from view. This one involves an incorrect assertion in the United Nations 3,000-page report on climate change in 2007 that the Himalayan glaciers could disappear by 2035. The UN acknowledged the error and promised to tighten its review procedures, close quote. In other words, nonsense.
Yes.
And it all continues to roll along.
Move along, nothing to see
here. So the state of play is what?
It's like the final scene of Terminator 2. No matter how many times, well, we keep killing the devil, evil robot machine, uh-huh, and it keeps coming back.
Right.
Because there are so many powerful vested interests, the National Academy of Sciences, NASA, GIS, all the rent-seeking corporations which have got skin in the game. They are making so much money out of
off the government,
off the taxpayer. You know, you've got the solar panel boondoggle. You've got the wind power boondoggle. These industries would not exist except through taxpayer subsidy.
So the argument that climate skeptics, yeah, such as James Delingpole,
yeah,
are one way or another being subsidized by major oil companies.
Oh, I wish, Peter, I wish.
But has anybody ever added up,
yeah,
what Exxon has spent to get studies conducted versus what the federal government, go ahead.
They have. There's a blogger called Joe Nova in Australia who's calculated that the various interests pushing global warming have spent 3,500 times the amount that skeptics have been paid by, you know, the Heritage Foundation, the CEI or whatever, to pursue their defense of truth.
Okay. Last question about global warming. You said that it has a kind of achieved the status of a sort of religion.
Yes.
You also mentioned that you think it grew out of the affluence of the 90s. Mm. Back during the 70s, there was concern about global cooling, actually, yeah, at the time. So the question is, what is it? There is something, and you mentioned that it's like Terminator 2. I don't remember that scene. Mm. But this thing that you can't kill, it keeps coming back. There is this kind of collectivist impulse,
yeah,
that seems to recur again and again and again. And at one moment it may take in the West the form of a kind of soft identification with communism and the statist impulse, growth of government we see again. Margaret Thatcher tries to bat it down in Britain. She seems to succeed. Here's the point. Margaret Thatcher, Ronald Reagan during the 80s seemed to be getting someplace. Mm. And now here we are back in the same hole. And this collectivist impulse at the moment takes a number of forms, but one of them is the global warming. So why is that?
I think there is, within the human species, an atavistic impulse for self-hatred and self-destruction. You look at the medieval times when people sort of sought to atone for their sins by wearing hair shirts. You saw in primitive times, people would sacrifice virgins to the sun god or whatever in order to appease the sun god for our sins against the world. Every generation believes...
So it's a feel expiation.
Every generation believes that it is the one which is so important that it has in its power the ability to destroy the world. And it wants to punish itself and torture itself. And this, of course, elides with another instinct, which is to... People like to control other people's lives. I mean, as a libertarian, I believe
the
exact opposite.
Right.
The impulse to power. This will never go away. Right. So when these two impulses unite, it becomes very powerful and very dangerous.
Segment 5, our final segment. I have seen America's future from James Delingpole's book, Obamaland. Mm. Quote, think of me you as the hero of H.G. Wells' The Time Machine, bursting into the American present, my clothes all tattered and torn, and on my face an expression of dire horror and impending doom. For I am afraid I have a terrible message to impart. I have just seen your future. I'm sorry to say, it sucks. How is it that James Delingpole has seen our future?
I wrote those words in 2008, before Obama came into power. I guessed he was going to win the election. And I think you should call me Nostradamus, because every darn prediction in that book has come true. How did I know? I had seen the Mark I prototype of Obama in the form of Tony Blair. I'd seen what Tony Blair had done to Britain.
Has he done to Britain? Hold on. Let me make an argument for Tony Blair. Tony Blair, the crisis of the late of 2001 is whether or not the West will unite to stand up to Islamism. And Tony Blair does stand with the United States. Yeah. You argue Iraq was a mistake, but Tony Blair had the courage to stand up to a direct threat to what was left of Western civilization.
You've just focused on the one morally good and decent thing Tony Blair did in his entire career.
And on the opposite side of the ledger, what did he do?
Domestically, he was a disaster. You remember when Obama came into power? He did not come into power as a kind of out-and-out Marxist, which he since revealed himself as. He came out as the healing president, the president.
Do you know what I love about you, James? Shades of grey, shades of grey.
Yeah.
All right, so carry on. Go ahead.
I'm very nuanced that way. He came into power as the healing candidate. That a lot of people thought that his skin colour would encourage the world to stop hating America. That it would unite in this big puddle of warm, gooey, touchy feeliness. Tony Blair, in the same way, masqueraded as the voice of sweet reasonableness. And so, you know, almost as a kind of semi-conservative socialist. What in fact happened was that while he sort of had these focus groups trying to decide what people would want and try and make everyone happy, the left hijacked the various institutions, you know, took over the schools in true Gramsciite fashion, took out over the seats of learning, took over the media, made all these politically correct regulations, introducing a form of communitarianism, which I think has been one of the greatest disasters for Western civilization. Communitarianism is like the softer face of communism. Everything is done for the community.
So while Tony Blair was floating above the political landscape like a big balloon in the Macy's parade.
Yes.
On the ground, the already vast administrative state of Britain
swelled
and became harder, became more left.
And became
Is
more
that
en-
right?
and more entrenched. I mean, the size of the state increased dramatically under Tony Blair. And once the state has increased, as you're going to find in America too, it is very, very hard to dismantle. You know, when Obamacare comes about, if it comes about, you try dismantling that system. It's going to be a problem.
Okay, hang on right there. Obamacare, James. Yeah. Listen to this. The United States spends 17% of GDP on healthcare. The next nearest nation, the Netherlands, is only 12%. Obamacare will take us in the direction of government-controlled healthcare. It'll be a step or two in the direction of the British National Health Service. But what really would be so bad about that? Michael Moore.
I was wondering, though, what's it like for the doctors here in Britain who have to live under this kind of state control?
And you're a family doctor?
Yeah, I suppose we'd call them GPs or general practitioners here.
Uh-huh. Right, so you have like a family practice of...
Yeah, it's an NHS practice. We have 9 doctors within that practice.
And you're paid for by the government?
Paid for by the government.
So you work for the government?
Oh, yeah,
you're
absolutely.
You're a government-paid doctor?
Absolutely.
A patient comes to see you. Before you treat them, do you have to call the government insurance company before you can treat them?
No, I don't deal with money at all on an everyday basis.
Have you ever had to say no to someone who was sick and needed help?
No, never.
Have you heard of anyone being in the hospital and being removed because they couldn't pay their bill?
No, never. And I wouldn't want to work in that system.
Yeah. The doctor told it like it is. He's completely unaware of the connection between money and the service he provides. And the problem is that as medical technology gets more sophisticated, so it gets more expensive. If you remove the connection between the service that you're providing and money, you have a recipe for an endless drain on state resources. There has to be some connection between the service you get and the money that you pay. In Singapore, for example, people have a system. They have a system where you can, if you don't want to spend your medical insurance on expensive treatment, there is a benefit at the end of it. There is an incentive for the customer not to use the service if they possibly can. In Britain, anyone can turn up to their GP, their doctor, anytime. They don't pay any money for it.
What's so bad about that? Look at that that well-spoken doctor who's enjoying life and providing excellent. But seriously,
who is paying for often sad, lonely people with nothing really wrong with them to go to the doctor at the expense of the taxpayer? You know, it is a drain on the government's coffers. The National Health Service is the biggest drain on the state.
All right. You want the United States to avoid becoming a permanent Obama land by turfing out President Obama in the coming election in favor of Rick Perry, Herman Cain, Newt Gingrich, Mitt Romney? Tell us, James.
I would like none of the above candidate. Can you offer me one of those? I'm very, very
worried.
You
would like the White House to, if there were an option, you'd like to let it sit vacant for 4 years. Let's lie fallow for a bit.
I think it is terrifying that a president on whose watch the U.S. national debt has risen to $15 trillion is yet looking like he may yet have a second term. What are the conservatives in America going to do about this? The candidate list is not very impressive. If it has to be Mitt Romney...
he's governor. He knows how to win election in a blue state. He was governor of Massachusetts. Yeah. Tremendously impressive career in the private sector. Articulate, well-spoken, more conservative than not. He'd be better than Obama. And with the impressive leadership, Republican leadership in the House of Representatives and in the Senate, with them working with Romney, things would be fine. That's the argument.
Yes, the argument. I think he's another David Cameron, frankly. I think he's a
mutant. You've already made it clear he's how damning you can
He's a
that.
Rhino Republican.
I
don't know what we're going to do. Right. I do know that these are desperate, desperate times.
Okay, desperate times.
Yeah.
We spoke earlier about the decline of Europe.
Yeah.
Not just the European Union, the political construct, but sort of the decline of Europe as a civilization.
Mm.
Let's take the weakest case, Greece.
Yeah.
All right. Greece may be broke. I grant you that it's broke. But at the end of the Second World War, the Germans had burned 1,000 Greek villages. Mm. They had destroyed every major road, all telephone lines. They had destroyed all the equipment in Greek ports. The country was in civil war with communist insurgents fighting the monarchical government. And 80% of Greek children tested positive for tuberculosis. Greece is undergoing a very rough period, and by comparison with a decade ago, it may look poor, it may have a decade of rough time, but it is still a prosperous nation. All those villages have been rebuilt. They all have telephones and televisions. And Greece has, not functioning very well by the standards of 1,000 years of parliamentary history in Britain, it has a functioning democracy which has just gotten more democratic as the Greek people have said, we don't want this kind of bit. Yeah. Greece is, this is not the end of anything. It's fine, James.
Peter, can I sound an uncharacteristic note of optimism? I was feeling very low
I was hoping you would.
I'm going to cheer all your viewers up.
I have worked so hard to find one note for you to sound, James.
I was feeling very, very bleak. I think the next 10, 20 years are going to be a period of no growth, maybe even negative growth. I think there are going to be wars, riots, destruction on an epic scale. I think there's probably going to be monetary collapse. I think my children
have
no future.
This is why we all call you behind your back Sonny Jim.
Yeah, exactly. However, in one of my low moments, I went into Ely Cathedral the other day. I don't know whether you've ever been there.
It's in Cambridgeshire, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
This beautiful cathedral, and I went inside and I looked around and I looked at the ceiling, and I just thought, if man can build something as beautiful as this, then there is hope. There was always hope. I have faith in the human species, not in our political systems. It may be that this crisis is, as Rahm Emanuel would say, an opportunity. Maybe it's time to regroup.
Okay. Last question. This will take a bit to set up. Okay. Because I'm going to read you two quotations and they're longish.
Okay.
But I think they square up a question for you. Mm. William F. Buckley Jr., you know of him. Right. Addressing a 1960 rally to protest a visit to the United States of Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev. Mm. Quote, "Ladies and gentlemen, we deem it the central revelation of Western experience that man cannot ineradicably stain himself, for the wells of regeneration are infinitely deep. Khrushchev cannot take permanent advantage of our temporary disadvantage, for it is the West he is fighting. In the end, we will bury him." Quotation two, Mark Stein in his new book, quote, "Look around you. From now on, it gets worse. In 10 years' time, there will be no American dream any more than there is a Greek or Portuguese dream. For a while, there may still be an entity called the United States, but it will bear no relation to the Republic of Limited Government the first generation of Americans fought for, and life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness will be conspicuous by their absence."
Yeah.
James?
Stein's book ruined the end of my summer. I've been thoroughly depressed ever since. I think there's a lot of truth in his analysis, and he's got lots of figures and facts to support it. Nevertheless...
The wells of regeneration. Place yourself in your mind, back in Ely Cathedral.
Well,
James.
I know. I think particularly in the case of America, there is something built into your DNA, a sense of optimism, a sense of, you know, you fled Europe in order to seek liberty. I mean, admittedly, you're a bunch of Puritans, and the kind of liberty you wanted then wasn't fun liberty. But nevertheless, I think those instincts, the instincts that motivated the founding fathers. I mean, I think you were very lucky with your founding fathers. I think if you go back to the Constitution, if you cleave to your Constitution, I think there is hope for America, and by extension for the rest of the world, because you lead the world.
James Delingpole's latest book, once again, Watermelons, The Green Movement's True Colors. Take a look at his Coward series of comic novels, which are brilliant. Social critic, novelist, and issuer of Jeremiads, yes. James Delingpole, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
I'm Peter Robinson for Uncommon Knowledge. Thanks for joining us.